Gentlemen, welcome to the session, Judicial Activism or Judicial Overreach, the Politics and Jurisprudence of the Chaudhry Court 2005 to 2013, edited by Ijaz, Shafi, Gilani and Moeen H. Cheema. I would like to make a couple of announcements before we start the session. Please either turn off your cell phones or switch them to silent. It will be greatly appreciated if silence was maintained throughout the session. Thank you very much. Our panelists for the session are Hamid Khan, Moeen H. Cheema, and Faisal Siddiqui. I will take this opportunity to introduce our moderator for this session, Ijaz Shafi Gilani. He is a chairman of the well-known political and social research organization Gallup Pakistan Limited with a doctorate in political science from MIT. He's a specialist in public opinion research. He pioneered the field of opinion polling in Pakistan and established the Pakistan Institute of Public Opinion, the Pakistani affiliate of the Gallup International Association in 1980. Presently, honorary senior fellow of the Pakistan Institute of Development Economics, Islamabad, he is also honorary dean of the Faculty of Management and Social Sciences, International Islamic University, Islamabad. I hand it over to you, sir, now.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Thank you very much for this introduction. We're sorry that the former Chief Justice is not here with us today, but he did promise that as soon as we have a formal launch of the book, that he will be with us in Islamabad soon to happen. This particular session, we thought, is more of a debate rather than a book launch. And the debate is on this issue of judicial activism, and has there been an overreach of the judicial activism? And there are, we understand, different points of views on this subject. In fact, this very debate on the overreach issue prompted us to start writing for this book. And as someone like me, who is not from the judicial community, but comes from political science and more empirical political science, we thought we should look at the 300 or so cases which were judged by the former Chief Justice Iftikhar Chaudhry during his tenure from 2005 to 2013. So we looked into all of those 300 cases, who were on the litigant side, who within the government was the respondent, what were the issues, on what grounds were the decisions taken. And the 10 papers which form this book soon to be launched are deeply informed by that empirical evidence of the 300 cases judged by Iftikhar Chaudhry during that tenure. The title of the book itself is Politics and Jurisprudence. Because the essential subject is jurisprudence, the debate nevertheless is, has politics gone overboard what was required by the jurisprudence? So we will welcome a debate. We will have about 20 minutes or so for the debate, 30 minutes for the speakers. We have an eminent list of speakers as it comes. Two of them have written papers, and Mr. Hamid Ali Khan, who's also an author of a celebrated book used by a lot of students on the constitutional law of Pakistan, is with us here as well. The only boundary to this debate of the subject is that it is about the constitutional rule of law. So the subject, as we discussed, we must keep in mind that the overreach discussion or judicial activism is within the boundaries of a constitutional rule of law, and who is the custodian of that constitutional rule of law? It is only fortunate and just coincidental that this morning news, the headline is about the local body elections. These local body elections, in some ways, happened because the judiciary asked the government to hold them. Apparently, the Supreme Court said, we will be in session late at night as long as you wish, but you have to come and respond and hold, give us a date to hold the elections. So that is a great evidence of how judiciary impacts political decisions, the headline of today. whether the activism issue is a matter of principle, judicial activism is right or wrong on the matter of principle, or a specific decision that the court takes should also be part of this debate. With this introduction, I will first turn to Mr. Moeen Cheema, with whom I'm the co-editor of this book. Mr. Faisal Siddiqui, who's a prominent lawyer, has written a very important chapter in the book, and he will be a speaker. And Mr. Hamid Ali Khan, who is very well known and a leader of the legal community, will be our third speaker. I have, by way of constraining my own colleagues, brought a clock with me. So each one of you has 10 minutes. Please go ahead, Mr. Moeen Cheema.
Well, hopefully I'll stay within the time. We'll have an opportunity for question and answer later. So good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure and a privilege to be here and talking about a topic which is of great interest to me as a legal academic, not just in Pakistan, although this particular work focuses on a particular period or era in our Supreme Court. But I've been fascinated by the use of this particular term, because it's quite ubiquitous in public discourse in a number of common law jurisdictions, particularly in the Global South. So I've been quite fascinated by why and how this term arises, how people use it in not just in legal discourse, but in general public political discourse. Interestingly, who uses this term, who employs it, and for what kinds of purposes. So my perspective in that sense, and what I will talk about today, is while it arises to a great extent out of this particular book and about the Pakistani situation, is a little bit more theoretical and a little bit broader in that particular sense. Before I go on about that, let me just sort of an addendum to what Dr. Gilani said. If you notice the title of the book, The Politics and Jurisprudence of the Chaudhry Court, looking at the 10 papers or so, it's not just about the 300-odd cases that the Chief Justice, former Chief Justice himself decided. It is actually about the role of the Supreme Court in that particular period, whether people were supportive of the actions of the court or opposed to it or critical of it. One has to acknowledge that this was a fairly unique, very interesting period in our constitutional politics and in our judicial history, and it merits to be looked at a bit more closely beyond the sort of discussions that we've had in op-ed length pieces, etc., or on talk shows. So I think as a legal academic, it just was impossible not to pay attention closely to the role of the court, in which the Chief Justice had a very particularly prominent role, but the court is an institution which is beyond, much bigger than the Chief Justice alone. So I just wanted to quickly make that point. Okay, so when we talk about judicial activism, what do we really mean by this particular term, which has dominated, I would say, if not dominated, has been very prominent in our political discourse, particularly surrounding the role of the court. When I look at the term judicial activism and how it has been used in Pakistan, and not just in Pakistan, but in a number of other jurisdictions, it appears that the term usually is used in two slightly different senses, actually. There's a positive sense in which the term judicial activism is used. And when it is used in that particular sense, it is actually contrasted with, the term is always used in a binary formation, as opposed to or contrasted with something else. And in the positive sense of judicial activism, it is contrasted with judicial quietism or judicial passivity. So the idea that a court, judicial quietism, passivity, refers to the notion that a court or a judgment that a particular court is being very conservative, highly legalistic, or even pedantic in terms of slavishly following the established interpretations of the constitutional or statutory text or its established precedent. So opposed to that, judicial activism is then presented as a bit of a good thing, a court beyond going beyond mere pedantic obedience to established precedent, but taking into all certain policy and broader issues of justice into consideration. But the term is, of course, more often than not used also in a negative sense, which is the kind of usage that we've seen in Pakistan quite a bit in recent times. And in that negative sense, the term judicial activism is then equated with judicial overreach, which is what the title of the talk today also suggests that. And so if you think about the term, both the positive and the negative sense of the term is actually used to convey, although they might sound like actually very different ideas, but collectively they convey the same sense. And it is this idea which in many ways is very similar to enlightened moderation. This idea that the appropriate role for a court is somewhat of a golden mean on the one, you know, between judicial quietism or too much legalism on the one hand, or too much activism or overreach on the other hand, and that there's this wonderful balance, a golden mean in the middle. But the term doesn't actually tell us what that mean is, what that appropriate role for the court is. Supposedly it's the lawyers and judges who are the repositories of special knowledge as to how this particular balance is to be drawn. Another fascinating thing about the use of the term judicial activism from my point of view, which I've seen in Pakistan and I've seen elsewhere as well, is that it is used to draw this distinction between law and politics. Even when we're talking about apex courts which deal with constitutional issues, which deal with issues of administrative law, with issues of rights, there's this idea that is, and it's in many ways in amongst legal circles, it's a fairly dominant idea that the role of the courts is only to do law and not to engage in politics. So if they engage in a little bit of judicial activism, that's a good thing, but if they engage in too much judicial activism or perhaps activism around certain sets of issues, then they become politicized. They start acting like political institutions. Now, I'm highly critical of this notion. I'll just very briefly talk about it, and maybe some of the specifics can come up in the question and the answer session. How am I doing for time, actually? Oh, I've got 5 minutes. Okay. This notion of an apolitical court is actually hugely problematic. Particularly, we can have apolitical courts at the lower levels, which deal with criminal justice. You can make that argument there, or with family law or property, even though I even question that particular notion. But this idea that apex courts with constitutional and administrative law jurisdictions can be truly apolitical, can only do law and not politics, is hugely and fundamentally problematic. I think this is an idea that we've actually borrowed. This is part of the the colonial burden that we still carry with a great deal of gratitude. These are ideas which have come from other legal systems and were developed, I think, to a great extent, or perhaps make a bit more sense in the context of other legal systems, perhaps Western legal systems, to a much greater degree than they do here. I would actually essentially argue that the ground realities in places like Pakistan and in many parts of the global south are actually fundamentally different. Pakistan, we are a place which is characterized by such deep inequalities in the social, political, economic, and from my point of view, most fundamentally, in the given context, also in the legal domain, that there is no terrain of neutrality. So no court, from my point of view, is actually apolitical. It's just that the quietest courts, or some courts, are better at hiding their politics than other courts. For some courts, like the Chaudhry Court, the politics is overt. You might like it, you might dislike it, you can critique it, but it's out there, much more easier for people to see. At times, perhaps like we are in right now or approaching, our courts tend to be quietest. They tend not to take up highly charged political issues. But from my point of view, that does not mean that they are apolitical institutions. It's just that they are espousing a very different kind of politics, which is harder to discern and hence harder for people to criticize. Critique and to appreciate. You might agree with the politics or you might disagree with the politics, but the argument that I'm not willing to brook is that these courts are actually being, or a court like this is being actually apolitical. So from my point of view, fundamentally, the question is not whether a court is being political or apolitical, whether it's acting as a political player or not, because it always is. From my point of view, the really meaningful question that we ought to always be asking when we deal with such courts with constitutional and apex administrative law jurisdiction that deal with questions of governance, human rights, and a whole range of socioeconomic policy making, even if it is through their inaction, is to ask what really is their politics. who benefits, who gets disadvantaged, what is the consequence of these politics, even if it is the politics of inaction, as I've said. And from my point of view, that is the more meaningful level at which this discourse about judicial activism ought to take place. From my point of view, this term is fairly euphemistic. It's quite vacuous. It doesn't really convey either way what the right role for a court is. And as I've stated, that's in some ways the premise of the book. The chapters in the book engage, as is indicated, as said in the title, the politics and jurisprudence of the court, engage with this idea that here we had a court which was fundamentally engaging in politics at multiple levels. And for the contributors, if not for all of them, for many of them, the question was unveiling what kind of politics that was, good or bad. That evaluation judges on your politics, on what your criteria for evaluation are. So I'll just leave it at that, and we can talk about maybe some of the specifics.
Thank you very much. I think there'll be a lot of debate on this subject. Essentially, what you're saying is that apex courts should not be apolitical. Some hide their politics, others reveal it, but those who reveal it provide greater opportunity for debate. Hopefully we'll have some. Our next speaker is Mr. Faisal Siddiqui, who's written an excellent paper on public litigation issue. He's also introduced, by the way, in our terminology, the term public speaking judges. And that was during the Chaudhry Court period, referring to the court of that period. So Mr. Faisal Siddiqui.
Thank you. It is indeed a pleasure to speak at this gathering. Moeen has explained what this term judicial activism or judicial overreach means in the academic literature, but let me start from a premise. To me, the question is, why did the court become active after 2007? Or why did it overreach in that sense that it started doing things which apparently it was not doing before? So I start that as a definition of what I mean by activism and overreach. Before criticizing what the court was doing, one needs to understand A, why it happened, and number two, what was the expression of what this judicial activism or judicial overreach was. Now, why did the court become so active? Or why did this court started overreaching after 2007? I think what happened is that dramatic event on March 9th, 2007, when the Chief Justice was removed. I think what the court realized on that day and thereafter is that their old source of judicial power, jisse unki kursi bachi rehti thi, which was based on the support of lawyers and part compromise with the elite, whether it's the political elite or the bureaucratic elite or the military elite, that no longer worked. They had a constitutional guarantee that they could not be removed, but this was this dictator who just one day decided to call the Chief Justice and remove him. So they realized that, there's the source of their judicial power, their judicial independence, their judicial kursi, has to be based on something else. So they changed their source of social power. And I think what happens in that movement is that the source of judicial power changes from an elite compromise or support of lawyers to what I call public legitimacy. What does that mean? What that means is that the court realized that the way to secure judicial independence or judicial power is to be popular, is to have public support, and more importantly, the threat of public mobilization. In Pakistan, where there are no long-term institutional guarantees for anyone's independence or security, the only thing which works in this country is street power. So I think that is what the court realized. So what you see is a change in the source of social judicial power. Now, how did the court sustain that? I think the way the court sustained that is that it introduced what I call the law model. It perpetuated a myth, which is what I call the legal ideology. It told people, the people of Pakistan, is that the solution to everything is the rule of law. So everything can be solved by applying the rule of law. That is why you see every dispute going to the Supreme Court. Now, at that time, there were two other models being perpetuated to solve the problems of Pakistan. One is what I call the political model, that everything can be solved through negotiations, give and take. And then there was the force model of the military, that everything can be solved through force. So the judiciary perpetuated its own model. The third reason why this overreach happened is that when the judiciary changed its source of judicial power, it realized that it gained a lot of power, and nobody wants to lose power. So it wanted more and more. And this overreach is also, whether it's good or bad, it's also a power grab. Institutions want power. One needs to understand that you can neither be good or bad if you have no power. So if you want to be good, you need power. If you want to be bad, you need power. So it realized that it wanted power, and public legitimacy and the law model gave its power. Now, what was the manifestation of this judicial activism? I think there are two basic manifestations. The first is that in Pakistan, now everyone knows this, that there is an unending list of laws within a endless sea of injustice. There is an amazing amount of injustice which is perpetuated in Pakistan. When it comes to the legal system, everyone knows what are the three basic sources of injustice. Number one, lawyers. Number two, procedures. Complicated, endless procedures. And number three, endless appeals. Disputes never end, appeals never end. Now, what the Supreme Court did in order to gain public legitimacy is that it dealt with all these three obstacles to justice. We need to understand that these justices are called Justice so-and-so. And the Chief Justice was Chief Justice. So the legal system is not simply about application of laws. It is also about justice. And what was happening in Pakistan is that there was too much law and too less justice. So what they did is that they said, forget about the rest of the courts. We will give you justice at the Supreme Court. Now what happens in 184.3, jise aap suo motu jurisdiction kehte hain, direct petitions kehte hain, is that you don't need a lawyer, there is no procedure, and there is no appeal. So it's like direct justice. And you know, I remember while sitting in courtroom number one, I remember that song from Ram Leela, jo Indian movie hai, aur usme wo jo hai ke Ram chahe Leela, Leela chahe Ram, to in dono ke love mein duniya ka kaam kya kaam. To main sochta tha ke Supreme Court chahe awam, awam chahe Supreme Court, in dono ke love mein kanoon ka kya kaam. So I mean, that is what the Supreme Court was doing. It was eliminated all obstacles and it was providing direct justice, and that was very attractive. What this led to is a radical increase in litigation at the Supreme Court. People don't realize that, and it's in the book, that between 2009 and 2013, 2 lakh complaints were filed in the human rights cell. 2 lakh complaints, and about 185,000 of those complaints were disposed of. So if you look at the cases, you will see that a lot of these issues were resolved. A second manifestation of this judicial overreach was that the Supreme Court engaged in macro transformation. So it said, we will fix the political system. So it started intervening in democratic politics. That these people can elect, these people cannot elect. It initiated an unprecedented, and that thing is now over, sadly, accountability of the military elite. That period, in which intelligence agencies, ki, missing persons, ki, jo accountability was not in Pakistan, nor was it in Pakistan. Third, what it did is that it dealt with one of the hottest issues on every Pakistani's mind, the law and order situation. It is the Supreme Court which really initiated the Karachi operation. It is the Supreme Court which really started this process in Balochistan. I remember the court sitting from 9 o'clock in the morning till 12 o'clock at night. And I can still remember that these missing persons, their children used to come from their schools. And they used to sit on the floor of the Supreme Court. in front, and the Supreme Court let them sit. The doors of the Supreme Court were open, whether that mattered or not, but the doors of the Supreme Court were more open than the doors of Hotel Carlton, which are apparently open but not open for everyone. It engaged in a lot of, it took up human rights violation, individual disputes. So you have a couple of shining examples in these cases. I mean, if you look at the Baldia case, people don't realize that in the Baldia factory fire case, the courts have awarded within a record time of 2 years the biggest compensation paid in any labor case in the subcontinent. So, I mean, it's these are remarkable examples of direct justice. The third thing, and I'll end here, what were the problems with the court? I think the court faced three major problems. The first problem, I think, was that what is central to a court's legitimacy is its perception of fairness. So yes, a court cannot be apolitical because it is dealing with political issues. The Constitution is a political document. They are like really like applied political scientist. But you should not seem like partisan. So what happened in political dispute and in certain individual dispute, and sadly the Arsalan case is one of the darkest periods of the court's history, is that it became partisan. It's not politicization which is an issue. It's partisanship. Everyone has political bias. I think the second problem is that the court did not overreach, but it overreached in terms of judicialization of everything. The point is, not every problem can be solved through the rule of law. And more importantly, not every problem should be solved through the rule of law. Rule of law may not be the ideal solution for every problem, but subjecting every dispute to a rule of law solution, I think, complicated matter. I think a third problem was that at the end of the day, the Supreme Court can engage in these periods of excessive litigation at the Supreme Court level, but at the end of the day, you have to engage in institutional reform. I don't think your current criminal justice system can be reformed. It has to be completely restructured, but at some stage you have to do that. The Supreme Court can't call all the cases from the lower courts, from the high courts, and deal with them. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you very much, Mr. Faisal Siddiqui, for an excellent exposition of the paper that you've written and many other points, especially for this trichotomy that you've come up with. Why did the Supreme Court do this? How did it manage to do that? And what are its implications for the future? Also, the three sources of injustice that you said it circumvented through this direct, as you call it, the direct legal intervention, and the three problems that people might do research, and many of our authors are here in the audience as well, as the three issues on which the future of a similar system might rest or be built up. With this, I turn to Mr. Hamid Ali Khan, our third and last speaker before we open the debate. Mr. Hamid Khan is very experienced both in jurisprudence and, may I say, Hamid Khan Saab, in politics as well. So you're the perfect example amongst the authors who actually bridges both jurisprudence and politics. Mr. Hamid Khan, please.
Thank you so much. I think Mr. Cheema and Mr. Siddiqui gave a very elaborate talk on the Chaudhry Court. See, to begin with, we have to understand the period of Justice Iftikhar Muhammad Chaudhry. He was one of the few Chief Justices in the subcontinent who can get a period of 8.5 years to serve as Chief Justice. In Pakistan, there have been earlier, Justice Cornelius was one who had 8 years as Chief Justice. And therefore, he left an impact on the jurisprudence of Pakistan. Then there was a 7 years period which Justice Hamoodur Rahman had, but unfortunately, it was a very difficult period in the life of this nation where East Pakistan was lost. So therefore, it was a divided period. Then came 8 years of Haleem, 1981. That was the worst period in the history of judicial history of Pakistan, and I would say the political history of Pakistan. Time of the dominance of Ziaul Haq, where judiciary did not matter. So therefore, it was one of the period of least judicial activism, or considered to be restrained from that point of view. After that, in India, for example, I would say there is only one example where a Chief Justice had more than 6-7 years. That was Justice Chandrachud from 78 to 85. Otherwise, they never had any such sustained period where they can find a policy and they can frame a policy and they can take court towards in one direction. So that is one thing that Khurramur Chaudhry initially had 8.5 years to do what he wanted to do in terms of judicial policy. But unfortunately, the first 4 years were lost in finding his feet. He was suspended, then he was removed, then all that went on, everybody knows. So therefore, the Khurramur Chaudhry became an effective Chief Justice in March 2009, not in June 2005. So that is one aspect we keep. So therefore, all that he had to do was in 4.5 years, not 8.5 years. So that was the time when he got free hand to develop whatever kind of jurisprudence, or we call it juridical politics, in that period. So that was one aspect of it. And considering that 4.5 years, I would say whatever was his output, it was considerable output on his part. Unfortunately, it's a fact that immediately after him, the court has gone back to the old times. It has been cut off like as if that period does not leave any legacy. That is another, because we are today sitting about 1.5 years after his retirement. And we have experience of 1.5 years after his retirement. And the pace at which it reverted back to its old times is also very considerable. And therefore, that's some of the ground realities that we are faced with. Coming to the book, for which I must say, Ijaz Gilani Sahab has worked very hard to put together these essays, and Mr. Faisal Siddiqui, Mr. Cheema, and other authors, they deserve compliment. Because it is, I think, the first time in Pakistan's judicial history that a book has been published on the judgments or judicial policies of Chief Justice, judges, or a judicial period. It seems that it has been a taboo in Pakistan. Don't write about judiciary, don't write about judges, don't write. One thing could be because judges have been scaring people off because of contempt of court proceedings. That may be one reason, but I think it has been overstated. Generally, people have said, or judges have, as a matter of policy, have been telling that the publication of the news regarding court should be avoided. And there was a mindset that the discussion on judicial proceedings is something which should be avoided in public domain. On that, I must say, this it's a beginning on the part of Justice Chaudhry that he made the debate open, even on the cases, on the daily proceedings in the cases, and all that was being frequently reported. And therefore, judiciary and its acts and its proceedings became a matter of public debate. And to bring that public debate out in the form of essays and this book, I must say, Oxford University Press and those the authors and the editors have done a tremendous job. There is one consensus we can say amongst, whether amongst lawyers, political activists, or the, that the period of Justice Chaudhry was certainly different than the previous periods of other Chief Justices. On that you can always agree. How far it was, the outreach was there, how far he had gone overboard, how far the court had taken a different direction, that's a different thing. But you can always say that this period has its individuality and its identity. That one thing we can all conclude, whatever may be our comments on that. Now, another area on which I'll make a small comment This is the first time a court in Pakistan had tried to venture into, naturally activism has been even Indian courts, but for the first time in the history of Pakistan, an effort has been made where the courts by on its own try to make inquiry into the facts or into the problems that was coming before it. This is not something unusual. The civil law countries or the continental law countries like Europe, this is something common. There the courts are activists. The courts have to follow inquisitorial procedure, meaning thereby they don't have to ask adversaries to produce the evidence. They, if they think the problem is very important, they themselves take the initiative and hold inquiry into it and ask the executive bodies to hold inquiry into it. This is what Justice Chaudhry was generally doing. He was holding himself inquiry into it and asking FIA, asking various agencies of the government, come forward and you bring in these facts before us so that we can determine those facts after this inquiry and give our judgment. So therefore, one thing which generally matter of great debate amongst the lawyers, it is not the role of the court to go itself into these areas. It's only for court to determine what is brought before it. So he outstepped that and tried to make the court an activist court or inquisitorial court to get into the inquiry about the matters of which it thought proper to make those efforts. And that was not something unusual or outside the jurisprudential limits recognized in the world. It is part of those jurisprudential limits. You see, we lawyers have our problem. Let me say, one thing good about this book is that it is half lawyer written and half political scientists, writing by political scientists. They have different perspectives, and that is very clearly seen. We lawyers, or judges for that matter, have our problems, have our mindsets. We think that the role of the judiciary should not to go out to look for the problems to resolve. It is for others to bring the problems before us, and in the first place we should try our best to express some sort of outrage. What is going on? Why is this inquiry room, or it is some is a courtroom? Why is this like that? Because it was something which we are not trained for. So therefore he was doing something which in the world jurisprudence is possible, but we are not we were not mentally or ready for that, and therefore there has been outrage also expressed in particularly in the judicial circles and the legal circles. Another thing about this book which I will like to give my small comments is that I must compliment the political scientists who wrote the essays in here. They have tried to test the decisions of the Chaudhry Court in the court of public opinion. And this Mr. Ijaz Gilani has done, Professor Ijaz Gilani did. And according to his findings, and since he is expert in taking polls, therefore that a majority of the people, and particularly those coming from downtrodden sections of the society, have expressed favorable opinion about the activism of Chaudhry Court. See, because what did a common man realize? What did a common man thought of these proceedings? He was thinking for some time that there is a court or there is a forum which is ready to listen to me, who has not been listened to ever, and is ready to bring about those people who are inaccessible to us before the court in front of me and made accountable to me. Many a times common people who had been the complainant had complaint had resulted in dragging inspector generals of police and chief secretaries of the provinces to come and face the court and say, this is the complaint, what do you have to say? This was something which was unheard of in the courtrooms before, that For a common man, the mere fact that this will can be even made accountable. Maybe he did not get anything directly in his favor as a result of these proceedings. But the very image, the very perception, the very observation on his part that, listen, we can make them accountable, was something for a common man which was something new and something for which was appreciated by that common man that, yes, at least there is a place where I can be heard. Now, coming to the next aspect, which that there was a lot of effort on his part, no doubt, and part of the court to try to redress injustices. But the effect of the matter is, unfortunate aspect of it, that we are a society where the problems and particularly injustices are so widespread and endemic that despite commendable efforts on his part for a few years, whatever has been achieved appears to be a drop in the ocean. Because there's so much injustice all around us. It begins from the very family, from the very house you are born up to the highest levels, that the judiciary has its limitation. Despite the best efforts made by it, we see the problems continue. This is unabated. As you see, there is again corruption in public places and public offices. That has not stopped, though he made a lot of effort to do that. But then, how much more could be done, considering the amount and the extent of corruption all around us? Then similarly, violence in Karachi continues, despite his best effort. Though I must say, Faisal Siddiqui is right, that at least he did show a way for an action to be taken in Karachi. Yes, to that extent, that effort on his part was fruitful. But again, it could not stop it, because it is too much. It has a lot of social, political, economic background to it that the court is helpless in stopping. Similarly, the violence in Balochistan, environmental pollution, discrimination against religious minorities. He tried to do whatever little he could, but it is such a colossal problem in Pakistan. The prejudice is something which is eaten into the roots of our society. Hatred and prejudice are two elements that in this society has virtually been extremely dangerous for us. And finally, one thing which is which has to be, I'll just conclude here, that judiciary has its limitation. One thing that has been proven by this 4.5 years of endeavor, that judiciary has serious limitations. It is not the organ of the state that can bring about the economic, political, social changes, though it was attempted. It needs a much bigger endeavor on the part of all organs of the state and all institutions in the country to bring about the change which was anyway attempted. At least we can say to the credit of the Chaudhry Court that it at least made a serious effort to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hamid Ali Khan. I think only your learning and deep experience of both the legal community and the general public can bring out such comments. I think Mr. Hamid Ali Khan did an excellent job in one explaining from which I learned why was the legal community, or at least an important part, which in my chapter I describe as the upper end of the legal community, had an outrage against those 4.5 years, as you explained. And secondly, why did the average citizen have such an infatuation? That infatuation I measured in my polls. Right after the Supreme Court made that decision, somewhat controversial, of dismissing a sitting Prime Minister elected by the Parliament, This was the high point of a political action by the Supreme Court to dismiss a sitting prime minister duly elected by the parliament. In the poll, the general public widely acclaimed 2/3 more, actually 70% or more, acclaimed the Chief Justice's decision. But what triggered my own interest in the subject was that when we looked at the voting intentions amongst those who in the future intended to vote for the People's Party, a majority of them supported the Chief Justice's decision rather than their political affiliations. This was the high point of the general public's infatuation with this, with that whole phenomenon. And I think Mr. Hamid Ali Khan has greatly been successfully described why that outrage, it was a departure from the tradition. Not from the global tradition, many other parts of the world, that's a known phenomena, but from the tradition of these particular courts, and why an infatuation amongst the person who saw justice as remote and distant. Well, how should one find a compromise out of these views supporting and opposing judicial activism, its overreach? The discussion and debate is open. I will take, you don't have to ask essentially a question, you can make a comment, as long as it's short. That's the only criterion. I think that hand came first. And I will, if you're short, we'll have many other hands getting a chance. Please.
Thank you. I was one of those few progressive people who are extremely skeptical about judicial activism even at its start. Because I was seeing that activism, that judicial activism would become the activism of a certain administrative unit and of a particular political ideology, that is of the Jamaat-Islami, Muslim League, and Punjab. Mr. Siddiqui said that the tradition of Sumato action was very attractive. There was an old sale of Sumato action, but the judge of Gharib Admi failed to open and even refused to open the case of the martyrs of 12th May. What was that hurdle that Mr. Chaudhry refused and failed to open that case? Secondly, that political activism, which was very much glorified and romanticized, when the point came of the military courts, the chief tere janissar beshumar beshumar, sare janissar jo aksar janissar military ke samne surrender kar gaye, aur koi itizaz mein koi nazm nahi likhi, aur koi jo hai nahi nikla, aur कोई वो नहीं हुआ, इसकी क्या वजह थी? क्या वो पॉलिटिकल एक्टिविज्म तो आर्मी ने तो स्टार्ट नहीं किया था? थैंक यू,
बहुत शुक्रिया आपने बहुत फ्रेंक डिस्कशन से आगाज किया. आप ये जो
जानने वालों के अलावा भी
अच्छा, मैं उनमें से किसी को भी नहीं जानता, वो जानने वाले तो हैं.
I'm Daniel, a final year. I'm Daniel, a final year student of law. I have a question for Mr. Faisal Siddiqui. So you spoke about the court basing its judgment on public opinion or street power. So when a Supreme Court of a country does that, isn't it shouldn't the court base its decision on the constitution rather than street power, public opinion? Because if it does base its decisions on the public opinion, it can and it quite often does go wrong. So for instance, how would you reconcile the decision of the Supreme Court in the Dr. Babarawan contempt of court case and in the Imran Khan contempt of court case? How would you reconcile both of these decisions? Thank you.
एक और सवाल लेता हूँ, आपकी ख्वाहिश में इतनी शिद्दत है कि आपसे पूछ रहा हूँ.
As a practicing lawyer, I expect कि बहुत जल्द आप लोग एक और किताब लिखेंगे, influence of the ex chief justice on the nomination of new judges or pasandida writ petitions jo unki imaa pe dali jati hain aur un pe aane wale pasandida faisle.
Sahi, to khud bahut jaldi likhiyega, apne kaafi issues hain. Main khair ek friend se bhi le lu, aap bhi par aise hi bol rahe ho, log sunenge.
Manzoor kaka,
ji bataiye.
Sir, as our Chief Justice was a very genius person, so he should have thinked the ground realities of this country. जब बाबर आवान 27 दिसंबर को कहते हैं कि बदकिस्मती से आज पिंडी से सिंध के तीसरे वजीर आजम की लाश जा रही है, तो जो बाद में कारनामे थे ना, वो सिंपथी में छुप जाते हैं ऐसी जजमेंट पे, जब साउथ पंजाब का एक इलेक्टेड प्राइम मिनिस्टर को सैक किया जाता है। नंबर टू, क्या ऐसी कोई रिकमेंडेशन दी थी चीफ जस्टिस साहब ने कि ये कोई आईएसआई का स्टेशन चीफ है या ये है या वो, इसको सैक कर दिया जाए? मामा कदीर तो अभी भी रो रहा है। नंबर थर्ड पॉइंट इज, सर ने कहा कि उनको स्ट्रीट पावर या अवामी नुमाइंदगी या सपोर्ट चाहिए थी। सो कायदे आजम मोहम्मद अली जिन्ना वॉज अ ग्रेट एग्जाम्पल फॉर स्ट्रीट पावर, ही शुड हैव कम टू द पॉलिटिक्स। हामिद साहब हैं, चौधरी एतजाज एहसन हैं, so this is the way to do it, I think so. Thank you.
बहुत बहुत बेहतर है, पीछे कहीं मुझे खड़ा होना पड़ेगा
जरा, एक हमें भी
ऐसे ना, तो जो सबसे आखिरी हाथ है उसकी बारी है। आप जो चेकर्ड शर्ट में
बात करते हैं,
लेकिन शॉर्ट प्लीज।
सर, माय क्वेश्चन इज रेफर्ड टू मिस्टर सिद्दीकी, एज ही स्पोक दैट the gates and doors were open of this Supreme Court for the children of those who were missing. Why the gates were not open for those who were missing? Because of the persons who were being treated in missing, like the terrorists who were the cause of many children who also lost their parents. Why were the gates not open for those children as well?
मिडिल से कोई पीछे पूछ सके, कोई सब इतने यंग लोगों को चांसेस मिल रहे हैं, कोई सीनियर तो
हेलो, आई एम राहुल सिंह फ्रॉम इंडिया।
पहले हम ये करते हैं।
अच्छा, ओके
बैठ जाइए प्लीज।
आई एम बेसिकली प्रोटेस्ट एक्टिविस्ट, और हमने ये जो लॉयर मूवमेंट है उसमें पहले दिन से लेकर आखिरी दिन तक मार खाई, और उसमें हमें उम्मीद थी कि एक सोशल चेंज होगा, क्योंकि हम एक्टिविस्ट थे। हमारे साथ ये भी नहीं था कि हम सिर्फ बाएं बाजू के थे, हमारे साथ हमारे दाएं बाजू के लोग भी सारे शामिल थे, लेबर भी शामिल था, ट्रेड यूनियनिस्ट भी थे, शायर भी थे। वी थॉट दैट ए डे हैज़ कम दैट दिस सोसाइटी विल चेंज, हमें एक बहुत बड़ा सोशल चेंज मिलेगा एट द एंड ऑफ द डे, इसीलिए हम इसमें शामिल हुए थे। लेकिन ये क्या हुआ कि एट द एंड ऑफ द डे वो जो एग्रीरियन सोसाइटी में जो लोअर जुडिशरी है, दैट बिकम इफ नॉट मोर करप्ट, नो चेंज हैज कम एट ऑल। तो इसकी वजूहात भी आपको हमें बतानी होगी कि ये तीन साल, साढ़े तीन साल या चार साल जो कुछ भी हुआ, इतना बड़ा मूवमेंट चला, इतनी मारे खाई, इतने लोग जेल गए, उसका इम्पैक्ट सोसाइटी पर क्या पड़ा? क्योंकि एवरी थिंग इज सबसर्वियंट टू द सोसाइटी, सोसाइटी से ऊपर कोई चीज़ नहीं है। अगर मूवमेंट थी तो उसको सोसाइटी पे इम्पैक्ट करना चाहिए था, एंड देयर वाज नो इम्पैक्ट एट ऑल।
राहुल सिंह फ्रॉम इंडिया।
दो तीन सवालों
आई वुड जस्ट लाइक टू से हाउ सिमिलर द प्रॉब्लम्स दैट हैव बीन मेंशनड हियर आर इन इंडिया। देयर आल्सो नानी पालकीवाला, वन ऑफ आवर लीडिंग जूरिस्ट, ही सेड टू मेनी लॉज टू लिटिल जस्टिस, and I heard the same thing here, too many laws, too little justice. And I would like to also just mention that, you know, what I would like to the panel to answer, what happened when the governor of Punjab was assassinated, how come there were so many lawyers who sympathized with his assassin?
I'm not a legal expert, I'm a development sector practitioner, and with development perspective, I get the message that judicial activism is good. I just want to explore and ask the panel if it makes any recommendation of how we can make the judicial activism not personality centric, but how can we institutionalize it in the judiciary?
Thank you. I'm afraid the time, except for Mr. Attlee, I think we'll also invite one non-Pakistani to speak on the subject. But we will soon have one or more sessions on the book in Islamabad. So everyone who's not had a chance to make his comment or her comment, it is about persons, not just men and women, shortly. But Mr. Attlee, and then we'll have the panel respond to these issues.
Yeah, thank you very much. Very kind of you, Professor Gilani. I'm a practicing Norwegian social scientist. I think they went far too far. There is a reason that there is legislative, executive, and judiciary estates, and then the media, of course, and the civil society nowadays. So it is. I think to have these distinctions would be important. Whenever there is a major case, it becomes political, like in Norway with the tragedy with the terrorists who killed so many people, as you remember. It became political. And after the Second World War, the same kind of thing, and mistakes were made. I think it's important, of course, always, that the judiciary is independent and not popular.
Thank you very much, Mr. Attlee. I should now turn to the those among the speakers list. If you have any comments to make, I think some questions will refer to you specifically, Siddiqui, and to Mr. Doing Cheema.
I think there are two specific.
Showing me 5 minutes.
Maybe just short comments.
Another 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It's a lunch break. So
I think the
spillover.
Just too short. I think it's very important to understand, and I say it bluntly, that the Constitution has no meaning. The Constitution means what judges say it means. The interpretation of the Constitution changes with time. Now the question is, nobody really knows. Koi Constitution ke andar nahi go sakta ki discover kare. Ye ek myth hai ki uski koi true meaning hai. People come and interpret the question. The critical question is, in whose benefit the Constitution is to be interpreted. For me, the greatest problem of this society is that the poor have no say in the judicial system. That is a question which we need to answer. I think Iftikhar Chaudhry, with all his problems, took that question head on. And that is why suo moto jurisdiction direct, it is not, the judicial system was too based on what people in Acheson thought should be the meaning of the Constitution, or grammar school thought, or what the lawyers thought, or what a rich lawyer thought, or a big client thought. The people of Pakistan had no say in what the Constitution means. So that is the question which the Supreme Court deals with. So it's not a question of popularism, it's a question of who has the right to interpret the Constitution. That has to be addressed. The second point,
maybe you can come back to it. In the meantime, Cheema can answer.
Yes, I think that was the central point.
There is, by the way, an excellent article in this book which is about constitution with a small c and a constitution with a capital C, referring to this question in 10, 15 pages.
Okay, well, if I may just add to what Faisal has just said, and I think, you know, there have been some really fascinating questions, and starting with the very first one, and let's address that issue, I think, head on, and we need to be really explicit about this. So when we talk about judicial activism, although I've, you know, critiqued the term, I'll just still run with it. We saw an earlier period of judicial activism in the 1990s, for example, where our courts really expanded the writ jurisdiction. Well, what happened with that period of public interest litigation in the 1990s? By the end of the 1990s, it was evident to anybody, for example, such as Werner Mensky at SOAS, who looked at it, you know, that public interest litigation a little bit closely, was that it had been totally co-opted by our urban upper middle classes and certain elite segments. It became a very easy, bypassing a lot of procedural technicalities, a way for anybody who could engage a good lawyer to litigate certain sets of concerns against the government. So total co-optation, if not total co-optation, you know, predominantly co-optation of that public interest litigation by the end of the 1990s. compared to that, yes, in this particular period, because of the sort of reasons, I actually, you know, subscribe to Faisal's point of view, that the court was really looking out to broaden its public constituency. And yes, it catered to a much broader range of interest. I would argue a much more middle class range of interest, which centered around certain issues of governance, certain issues of accountability. It was to some extent, great extent, right leaning as well when it came to questions of, you know, so the question, you know, issue like why did the court not take up questions of, you know, religious violence, sectarian violence, etc. I mean, that's a, you know, that is part of the limitation of trying to be populist amongst a certain segment of society. So it tried to cater to a much broader range of interests, but one has to acknowledge that it was still a relatively limited set of interests, limited to middle classes, not the upper middle classes, now, you know, the urban middle classes, or perhaps even some, you know, some segments of the lower middle classes. But this is a sad reality of our politics, that when we talk about Pakistan, the core of this country has always been and continues to be North Central Punjab and settled areas of KP and Hazara. Balochistan has always been on the periphery. Southern Punjab has been on the periphery. So even a court which was trying to look out and address a much broader set of interests, class interests, regional interests, was still very much, you know, as the first commentator absolutely noted, was still fell within that pattern, and there were limitations to its, you know, outreach and its. There was also this fascinating question about, you know, the parallels with India. The parallels with India are absolutely fascinating. So, you know, certain kind of social action litigation happened in India in the 1980s. In the 1990s, there was quite a bit of a backlash, and even the Indian Supreme Court became quite pacifist, even, you know, quite conservative, bought on to the neoliberal economic agenda as well. And in the last, you know, decade or so, it has been making a bit of a comeback. But I think the contrast with India is also really, really fascinating, and it ties back to the first comment that I just made. The Indian Supreme Court, in its heyday of its activism or so-called activism, was interested in predominantly in what commentators have called social action litigation. Litigation around issues of socio-economic justice. And if we go back to the lawyers' movement, and, you know, if people remember, there was this wonderful poem that Ijaz wrote, which GOTB turned into this anthem of the lawyers' movement. And in some ways, this was the promise that the lawyers' movement held out to everybody else. And what was that promise? What will happen when the true judges will be restored? That's the language that the poem itself used. And there's this very poignant line in the middle, very moving. Riyasat hogi maa ke jaisi, har shahri se pyar karegi. Right? This was a promise of social justice. This was a promise not just we'll have good governance or accountability. This was a promise of that the court will reach out to issues of that really matter to the poor, which are issues of socio-economic justice. And I have to say, I've said that in my chapter as well. For me, this has been one of the big disappointments about this particular period, that those issues of socio-economic justice got left on the sides, and our public interest litigation never even approximated to anything close to social action litigation. Okay, I'll just leave it at that.
But, thank you very much. Would Mr. Hamid Ali Khan, I think he made a great point on the discontinuity issue, that it was a period which was a discontinuity with the past and is back to the past. Whereas a lot of discussion here also wishes to have that period with achieving new objectives. But would you like to say something on the question that
yes,
you raised?
Yes, just two questions which I thought I may make comments about. One was about Salman Taseer's murder. Please understand, lawyers' community is not a monolith. Everybody's like the same. It represents the entire society in the country, entire community. All kind of thought is there. Extremism is also there amongst the lawyers' community. If there are 40, 50, 60 lawyers who support that kind of an act, this only represents the overall community. There are such people. So therefore, if you lawyers are like that, doesn't mean that you should generalize lawyers on that basis. One thing. The other thing is, in any case, it is something which is heartening to our system that person has been sentenced to death by this very judiciary. and that his death sentence has been confirmed by the High Court here. So therefore, you have to overall understand that still the judiciary is one place where the prejudices are still not that strong. No doubt it must be, they are not free from all prejudices. This country is full of prejudices. The unfortunate part, which I already explained, our prejudice is something which has been one of the biggest problems that Pakistan faces. Coming to the second one, which you said, so I'll just answer in Urdu. आप ये तवक्को करते थे कि एकदम दुनिया बदल जाएगी, जैसे जब हम जाते थे जॉय साहब के साथ तो ये नज़म जिसका जिक्र मुईन चीमा साहब ने किया है, मैं कहा करता था कि खुदा के लिए लोगों की तवक्कोआत इतनी ना बढ़ाओ, अदालतों की बड़ी लिमिटेशंस होती हैं, जिसका मैंने जिक्र भी किया। ये जब कहा गया कि रियासत होगी माँ के जैसी, तो उस कोशिश में कहीं ना कहीं अदालत ओवरबोर्ड चली गई। ये कोशिश थी कि अब हम चूंकि इतने बड़े मैंडेट से आए हैं, हम सिर्फ अदालत के मामलात को दुरुस्त नहीं करेंगे, हम इससे ज़्यादा मामलात को दुरुस्त करेंगे। नतीजा क्या हुआ कि बहुत सारे अदालती मामलात जो थे वो नज़रअंदाज हो गए, और इस कोशिश में कि हम सोशल जस्टिस प्रोवाइड करें, इकोनॉमिक जस्टिस प्रोवाइड करें, पॉलिटिकल जस्टिस प्रोवाइड करें, उसमें बहुत सारे मामला जो कि नीचे की अदालतों के बेहतर हो सकते थे अगर तवज्जो उस तरफ दी जाती, तो शायद ये जो आप फरमा रहे हैं, और बहुत से लोग कहते हैं कि जी हम सिविल कोर्ट जाते हैं वहाँ तो करप्शन है, मैजिस्ट्रेट्स की कोर्ट्स में करप्शन है, जुडिशल मैजिस्ट्रेट्स ठीक नहीं है, सेशन जजेस में भी बड़ा मसला है, तो शायद उस तरफ ज़्यादा तवज्जो दी जानी चाहिए थी। मैं मानता हूँ, आप एग्री करता हूँ, लेकिन देखिए ना, जो एक मिजाज बना उस सारी मूवमेंट का, उससे जितनी तवक्कात बढ़ गई, तो नतीजा ये हुआ कि सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने अपने पर ये सारी जिम्मेदारी कबूल कर ली कि जी हाँ, हमने अब हर किस्म का मसला हल करना, कराची का भी मसला हल करना, बलूचिस्तान का भी मसला हल करना, जो थर का मसला भी हल करना। तो ये सारा उसके कॉन्टेक्स्ट में आप समझ सकते हैं, और ये समझें कि अदलिया की हमेशा एक लिमिटेशन है, वो एक हद तक ही कुछ कर सकते हैं, बाकी काम लोगों को करना पड़ेगा।
थैंक यू वेरी मच मिस्टर हामिद अली खान, एंड thank you very much everyone here. I think within an hour, just about 5 minutes overboard, we've been successful in initiating this debate, which to me is very central, not just to judiciary, but to the general politics and society of this country. I think that's an important point that I wanted to leave with you, and I think that's partly responsible for what I could see from here, very keen and deep interest in everyone. That's why we had more than half the hands risen, which we could not entertain. So there is a reason why everyone took such an infatuated, I use the same word again, interest in a very, what we call as legalistic meaning, very soft and dumb and not listened to. In such a legalistic matter, such an infatuated interest for so many years, even if it were 4.5, says there is a deep need for look into this subject. And there's not only just one side to this debate, or not one side to the performance of the Chaudhry Court. So we've been very successful, I think, in initiating that discussion in these 60 minutes, and I look forward to continuing this debate and discussion in the sessions that we will continue, and more broader in the academia, the legal community, and the general population. Thank you, everyone. Thank you all, Mr. Hamid Ali Khan, Mr. Siddiqui, Mr. Moeen Cheema, and all of you. Thank you again.